headquarters is worst. You know, every time people in the mission says, what these people sitting in Brussels are doing? I send him a mail and 2 hours and he doesn't answer. Yeah. It's what everyone thinks in the field. But when you're in the office, you receive 150 mails per hour. So it's impossible to answer every single mail the first day. You know? In Brussels, the problem of MSF that we are an emergency or driven organization. So you never know what is going to happen tomorrow. And you are in this emergency mode all day, and it tires you a lot. Because all of a sudden there's an earthquake, I don't know where, in Indonesia, and actually you need to send the things, but it was better to send them yesterday. So it's, you feel that you are running behind someone. You never are behind this. You are in the rear side. It's very difficult. When you're in a mission, you only focus on your mission. And it's fine. There's a lot of problems in any mission, but it's fine. But in headquarters, it's more difficult. And more difficult not only in terms of giving support. For us, for example, it's very difficult, especially because the gap between what you study in Lebanon and what you need to do in Africa is completely big. And every year is getting worse, bigger and bigger and bigger. And will come a moment that a doctor that study in a developed country will not be able at all to work there. You know, now I have anesthesiologists that they cannot intubate with a laryngoscope. They need a fibro and laryngoscope. I have now gynecologists that they cannot diagnose uterine rupture. They need an echograph. When the first thing they did me when I studied, I don't know if you still study in this, but when I studied medicine, they said, you need to see the woman like this. If you see that the belly is like this, it's a ruptured uterus. Yeah, you don't need to have an echograph to do so. You know, I just came from Burundi, where I have a very nice emergency doctor teaching people, because people come with pneumothorax due to gunshots, no? Emo pneumothorax, pneumothorax intention. So he was making training. I was sitting behind as a bad guy to ask the questions. And he asked to the student, and look, what do you think is the best tool to diagnose a pneumo hemothorax? Which? Yeah. One of the students said that, and he said, no, it's the ultrasound. Then I stood up and I said, no. Because I said to the doctor, look, do you think that in Burundi they are ultrasounds? And he said to me, yes, we have it here. Yes, it's an MSF hospital. But in the moment you cross the street, there's no more ultrasounds, never. And I think, in the moment you take the ultrasound, you put the ultrasound, you sit nicely, you put the gel, your patient already is dead. Yeah? So for me, a stethoscope is the most simple way and has been diagnosed for centuries. So why now we need to change? You know, this is a problem that every time we're getting less clinical. And please, you are young doctors, don't forget that all this laboratory X-ray imaging whatsoever is help in your diagnosis. Never accept to be your diagnosis. Because sometimes people say, but I put it, because the lab says, no, the lab can say something, but you need to have clinical way of thinking. So we move. Okay. So no, I don't know who will like ever be anesthesiologist from you. That's what you was asking. That's well, no, in Peru, exit from here. No. Yeah. So you know how is how we decide to be specialists. I don't know how you, because in Peru, mainly we study medicine to be doctors, not to have money, because, okay, we are very good paid, but we don't have private practice at all. Well, it's a little bit. And so when I was a GP, I said, no, I cannot stay as a GP. I need to be more competent. So then, which specialty I need to do? So the first that I ruled out was gynecology. Because I got traumatized during my internship. When all these women are shouting and they are scratching you. Then my mother told me, who beat you? No, mother, it was in the labor room. Oh my God. And of course they say, I will never have a more child. And after 1 year they're coming back. So really, really, I said, I was traumatized. I said, no. Then pediatrics, forget. Because in the moment you put a stethoscope, the child, wow, so you don't hear nothing. No, 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 no. Surgery? Oh, no. Because when I was also traumatized because now you have laparoscopic, no? But in my time, when I was studying, cholecystectomy was the worst because you need to be grabbing the carton like this, taking out. And if the surgeon doesn't see anything, the student is the one that is to blame, isn't it? So you don't see nothing because you are pulling out. So no, no. So what was I doing? And it's this. Yeah, but I love because I love medicine more than surgical, I love medical side. And anesthesia intensive care for me was more than I think. So I did anesthesia. But then of course, you have all these monitors, beam, beam, boom, boom, sounding all day, all these fantastic devices. You go to a congress and you see all this material that you even ask yourself, for what I will use them? But they want to sell you, huh? So you have all these things. Every time, everyone, new drugs, new names. So yeah, and then you fell down in these kind of conditions where we are. So I want to be a little bit what we do in the field as anesthesia, but it's also for surgery because actually we cannot divide surgery of anesthesia because they are coupled, but a little bit of the experience of anesthesiologists. So unfortunately for the anesthetist, we're the helpers of the surgeon because we do the best so the surgeon can do a good operation. But then we are blamed also, very often. But in the field, it's very difficult to do, even surgery, not only anesthesia, because there are several concerns. The first of all, resources are very limited. You don't have money, because okay, what if you go to work with MSF? MSF, I think, is fantastic in supply. But if you go with another organizations that are less fantastic, they're still fantastic, but a little bit less, then you might not have a lot of things. So you need to see what you have, what you don't have. Then, forget the word referral. Because if you go in a humanitarian, by default, you are a foreigner. By default, your hospital is the best in the area. So there's no way to refer. So you are the last point. And then you do what you can do, and then you live with what you did. Okay? Then, more often, patients come without any document. You hear, you say, what's your file? Ah, you got vaccinated, you had this, you had that. Ah, you was operated. Ask this to these people. They don't know even what is their age. So sometimes I remember in Congo, we were asking, do you know Mobutu? Ah, yes, I know Mobutu. Ah, so you was in that time living, you know, because they remember the president, but they don't know the age. Yeah, so it's more in countries as in Congo that they don't have winter and summer. It's almost the same all year. So it's, they don't have medical records. So you need to believe that they have everything. But if you're in the middle of the bush, 3,000 kilometers of a city, and you have 70 years, are you going to be ill of something? Why you say no? Yes, you hear Darwin, isn't it? Really, the theory of Darwin is very nice, applicable in this context, because people that arrive to 70 years, if malaria didn't kill, cholera didn't kill, nothing killed you, it means that you are very fitted. Forget that you're going to find in anesthesia to find a patient with hepatic insufficiency or cardiac 2A insufficiency. No, that doesn't exist in the field because they might have unfortunately, they had died before. So normally our patients are fitted and normally are young. Yeah, that's already good. But they come without records. However, we say every time, even the conditions are very difficult, every time it's possible to do good anesthesia. That is very good for the anesthetist. It's worse for the surgeons, because for the surgeons, they might not have a special forceps, a special thing, but the anesthetist having 3 or 4 drugs, we can do anesthesia. But as you need to understand also in these cases, we don't do elective surgery. Elective drops, because already put a patient under anesthesia is a risk, because we don't know nothing about him. So to do elective and that the patient will die, better don't touch it. So as I say, there's no differences between the anesthesia practice you do in Lebanon and what you can do, I don't know, in Somalia. Because intubation is intubation. Putting spinal anesthesia is a spinal. So really the technicity is exactly the same. What makes the difference are all the problems around you, not in your own practice. And as medical doctors, also we need to know that in that case, we should know when to not do harm. Because sometimes to try to do techniques that you do here might harm the patient. So what we do normally is critical surgery, patients dying, damage control surgery, as soon as possible. So someone knows what is damage control surgery? Someone can answer? Yeah, it's not only after trauma. You have a very ill patient in that context. Yeah, so a patient is very ill, so enters to the operating room. The only thing to do is to stop hemorrhage. Then you put packing, even you don't close, you send the patient back to whatever place you have, ICU, whatsoever, and in 2 days you enter again to finish the intervention. Then the probability of the patient that will be alive are much more than if you do all the intervention from A to Z. So it's very good. And also, as soon as possible, you have this very nice word in medicine, let's stabilize the patient. You don't have nothing to stabilize with. So the patient comes, you enter. Yeah, we need to save lives. Forget, you don't have referral centers, you don't know what the patient has, you don't have means, so you operate immediately. And the philosophy is to be the simpler, because we'll be the safer, to do the best for the most, and to have a lot of flexibility. So equipment. First of all, the standards are very, very basic. Very basic standards. Because in the hospitals, you might not have electricity. Also, you might have a little generator, but maybe without gasoline. So this generator might work for the emergency room, but when you do surgery, they turn off all the hospital, so your operating room is with light. So these people don't have monitors. Monitors and defibrillator are almost absent, because you can believe here, your monitor got damaged. You phone the IT, someone comes with a little chip, puts a chip, and the monitor is working. There, if something happens, forget. Because where you find the chip, first of all, and do you have the money? Second. So what we every time say, that at least you need to have a pulse oximeter, at least. Okay? And remember, for someone that is going to be surgeon in humanitarian, remember that your anesthetist is the multi-parameter monitor. Because sometimes the surgeon says, please, can you sweep my throat? Said, no, I'm taking the blood pressure, because you don't have monitors. And please, if the surgeons go down 2 hours and you are taking blood pressure every 3 minutes, you cannot afterwards even touch your ear. So it's a way, there's no monitors. And MSF, even if we can have them, we try to avoid to put too much technicity in some countries where they don't have it. Because we try to teach them to use the tools they have there. Nothing serves to bring him a fantastic monitor. They study a lot, and after, let's say, after MSF leave, 5 days, it gets broken, and they don't know how to take the blood pressure by hand. So this is what we need to do. Then ventilator, you saw here, very nice, no? The evidence says that, I don't know from where they said that we anesthetists, we love to drink coffee. Because there's someone working for us, and this is a ventilator. Actually, I don't like coffee, and I don't know who can take coffee inside the OT, but we have this fame. We don't have ventilators. We don't have machines. We don't have oxygen. So you can believe oxygen cylinder. Can you send this oxygen cylinder by airplane? Nobody will accept you to put an oxygen cylinder in an airplane. So we use mainly oxygen cylinders. Yeah? And you don't have anesthesia machines, you don't have ventilators, so what we use is the ambubag. That is why when we talk about technique of anesthesia, we try not to paralyze the patient. We try to keep the patient in a spontaneous ventilation even if he's intubated. Because in this photo of my colleague, he's intubated, but now he's a ventilator, bagging. So you lose one person in the team of the team only bagging. So you are doing everything. And you see here, another colleague, all these photos of MSF, you have the oxygen concentrator in the left side, and the fantastic anesthesia machine. I don't know how I can have a pointer here. I don't know, like this. You see here, this is the vaporizer that gives Allotan. So the vaporizer comes along, you attach to a trolley, and you have your fantastic anesthesia machine. Not the one you see in your hospitals here. It's what we have. So normally, our techniques, and I'm going to talk it afterwards. So the reality is that a lot of people says, oh, my hospital, we have these 5 operating machines that are used, but are new. Let's send them to Africa. Yeah, so you send these machines, beautiful machines, to Africa. What happens in Africa is that, for example, if you are in a British, former British colony, all the gauges to connect the oxygen all are British standard. You cross the river, and already was a French colony. So this is not more standard. So these poor people in Africa, they get so many things that they don't use it. Even I saw in Niger, anesthesia machine, new anesthesia machine, but all the instructions in Chinese. So who knows Chinese in Niger? No one. So what you find is this, what they call cemeteries. In all hospitals, if you go to a hospital in a low developed country, go and ask, can we go to the basement? You will see all this. Yeah. Even to the exaggeration that once in Afghanistan, they were looking for wheelchairs. We have a lot of wheelchairs. And the hospital, they got a donation of US of 150 wheelchairs. So I said, you have wheelchairs in Afghanistan. Huh? So I went downstairs, and all the wheelchairs had the big flag of United States. Of course, they couldn't give it to anyone. So it's a useless donation. But I don't know who can donate a wheelchair with the flag of United States to Afghanistan. So, you know, so this is what happens. Yeah, this is what happens. So if you find machines in the place, surgeons, if you are going to be ever surgeon, be aware that if you are going to use the electrobistory, you are not going to burn the patient. An anesthetist, if this machine is given the correct parameters. So better don't use them. So the anesthesia techniques now. So we need to consider risk and the benefits for the patient. Unfortunately, in anesthesia, in the field, there are more risk than benefit. Actually, the patient might die of anesthesia rather of his surgical disease. That is the unfortunate of our specialty. So what we do, all our drugs, should take account that we should avoid cardiorespiratory depression. Because then how you put it quickly? We don't have this, all these fan digoxy. We don't have them. Amiolarone, we don't have them. If we have them, I can use it because I'm a doctor anesthesiologist, but the nurses, they don't know. And I'm teaching them to work with what they have. Also, we intubate the patient to secure airways, and then the surgeon, as he can, he operates because the patient is like this. And then for suturing, again, we relax the patient so he can sit. But then we talk with the surgeon also. And also we go for low dependence in oxygen. We don't use too much oxygen. And of course, biomedical devices because we don't have electricity. However, we do give oxygen. The problem is that we don't have this fantastic flash that have the anesthesia machines now. So the lung we don't have because we have the oxygen concentrators give you up to 10 liters per minute of 95% of oxygen. Low pressure. So if a patient, here you see in reanimation, they put 15 liters, 20 liters. There you cannot put only 10. But this 10 already is good anyway, to have zero. So when you're going to make an intervention, then you need to talk with your surgeon. And you need to say, first of all, what's the patient's condition? And what do you have? You have enough drugs and equipment? And of course, the experience. The experience. Because if comes an anesthesiologist of 2 years of training from South Africa, he might be better dealing with a gunshot wound of the thorax than a UK anesthesiologist of 14 years of experience. Yeah? So we need to talk with the surgeon and also anesthetist. Yeah? I was working, as I said, you doing only laparoscopic cholecystectomies for years. So I'm not so good in neural blocks. But people that is working in a traumatic hospital, they are very good in neural blocks. So it depends. So we need to ask, who is who, because not all of us, we are equal. So first of all, I need to say that some techniques are absolutely not appropriate for the field. And this is, and I wrote by my position, I do write a lot of manuscripts, articles. And last 4 months ago, in the Journal of Anesthesiology, went a revision. I did a literature revision of the literature that we talk about the techniques we use in the field. And actually, it was very reward because what we are doing in MSF is what everyone is doing. So one thing that you don't see in this list is peridural anesthesia or epidural anesthesia. Do you know what is epidural anesthesia? It's the one that you can put catheters also for long-standing pain management. We don't do it because the technique is very difficult. And because you can puncture the dura, and then you have a lot of problems. You can get infected, you can get meningitis. So that is why even we don't have it in the list. Local, yes. When you go to the field, please don't bring lidocaine with epinephrine. Don't bring it. Because then people will begin to use local anesthesia in the fingers, and with epinephrine they want to get necrosis. So in MSF, we don't have epinephrine with our lidocaine. And don't also begin to make these experiments of drawing here, putting the nose. Use better the drug as it is. Spinal anesthesia, yes, we use bupivacaine. We use the heavy one. Regional box, yes, but only if the anesthesiologist is good. Please don't begin, do you have pain? Because the patient is screaming and screaming. No. Only if you have the means, and what we have is neuromuscular stimulators, we don't use ultrasound. Not because we cannot it, it's because the national staff will not have them. Yeah. Then, general anesthesia, the best drug in MSF is ketamine. Maybe here you don't have it more, but ketamine is the best drug ever for us. Yeah, it raises the blood pressure, opens the bronchia, so it's very good. and it's analgesic and anesthetic, so you don't need to use morphine on top of that. And we use in less extent thiopental or pentotal. We don't use it in less extent because normally when you induce a patient, the patient will have transitory apnea. And you will see your nurses how they good back with a mask. I saw once a patient in respiratory arrest, they were doing RCP, reanimation. Let's say this is the mouth of the patient. The nurse with the bag, like this. There was a difference of 30 centimeters between the mask and the mouth. So yes, because they are not trained. We cannot blame to them. You say to a nurse in South Sudan, what is the pulse? So the nurse began, 1, 2, 3. And then it's 80, doctor. Okay. After 5 minutes, what is the pulse? 80, and everything's 80. What happens is that she counts up to 80, and she says you 80. But she's not looking the clock. So you need to be very aware of all what happens. Huh? And inhalation anesthesia, in the world, they use Halotan. It's the most common. MSF, we have more better supply, so we use isofloran. Of course, we don't use sevofloran in MSF, yeah, because it's very expensive. And a lot of things. And of course, also, we don't use propofol in MSF, yeah? And inhalation anesthesia is very difficult because, as I told you, we don't have anesthesia machines, we don't have ventilators, so if you intubate a patient and on top you put inhalation anesthesia, then you are blocked completely. And then for an inhalation anesthesia, you will need to paralyze the patient. So on top of that, you don't have, and then you are alone, huh? You are alone. You don't forget that you don't have no one around. So what you might do, your cardboard, you put very big the letter of what is in, but you need to see what they're putting. And then you are bagging, no? So you have the pulse oximeter, two, 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 but then in the time you go to take something, you're hearing two, 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 two. And then you run back again and you begin. So it's very difficult. You see, it's very stressing. And then when you see that face of the surgeon, when he hears these sounds, that stress you more. So, yeah. So we don't use it. Surgeons can be scary. Yeah, so this is the problem. So what are our problems in pre-op? So we only do clinical assessment. We don't have laboratory diagnosis. I would like to be that in Belgium, you check all, and then even you don't see even the half of the results that you ask for. No, there you don't have, so you only do check what you see. As we have low resources, if you need to make a lab, you do it if really it's going to help you in your treatment. Don't ask for everything because then you don't get nothing. As I told you, we don't delay any surgery, so no time almost to do really a pre-operative assessment. And every time we consider the patient that have a full stomach. In intra-op, we don't have, as I told you, we don't do muscular relaxation. The anesthetist is everything. And unfortunately, as anesthetists, we need to do more things. We need to count the compresses, the gauzes. In these people, even they don't know how to count. So you need to begin to count the compresses because we say, before closing the patient, we need to have all the compresses out. So we have trolleys, cardboards, and this and that. And post-op is the major problem because you know that the people die in perioperatively, people die mainly in post-op. What is the most difficult when you fly an airplane? Take off, flying, or landing? What? Landing. Exactly, when we do anesthesia, we land in the post-op. It's when the patient doesn't get already the anesthesia, so he begins to breathe himself again. So it's the time you have the anaphylactic shocks, it's the time you have the cardiac arrest, all comes in this moment. Hypertensive crisis, so, and your staff is completely not trained. So sometimes what I did, if I have a very difficult patient and then comes another, I kept the patient inside the operating room. As I'm using ketamine, I put him on the floor, in a stretcher, not because he will move and he will fall down. So you need to be that these things are, and you have a, and sometimes you have a patient that is so bad in post-operative that you should delay all the other interventions because you need to be with him. Sorry, we have a case of a baby dying in Central African Republic in Bangassou because the nurse anesthetist, someone came to talk with him and he left to talk with a person and there was a baby in post-op, he vomited and he died. So because they don't know, it's not because he's a bad person, they don't know. You cannot ask someone to do something that he's not prepared for. Yeah. So, as I said to anesthetists and surgeons, everything should be very good written. In our trauma center in Kunduz, a patient came with a head trauma in the emergency room. And the doctor, the expert said, 10 of morphine, 10 of morphine, like this. But then, you have a translator that translates to Dari, from Dari to Parsi, to Farsi, or to Pashto. No? So it counts, I think, 4 times translated is 10 of morphine. All of a sudden, nobody was looking to this 10 of morphine because everyone was busy with the patient. It was a head trauma. Actually, I don't know even for what they give morphine, if it was a head trauma, okay. And the patient died. He did bradypnea, and then he died. And everyone was asking, why? When they saw the tray of the nurse, there were 10 ampoules of 10 milligrams of morphine. So actually, they gave him 100. And now they began, everyone, who is responsible of it? For me, it's the doctor that didn't say 10 milligrams. How the nurse understands. So in this context, you need to be very, very careful. Yeah. And as anesthetists, we have a lot of others, as I told you. But as there was a question, protocols are very important. Every hospital in the world is protocolized. You know, if you go to an emergency room, you follow the protocol. You don't invent your reanimation protocol. Why? Because it's also proven that it improves the quality of care. And you have people that didn't have almost no, absolutely not so much training, the protocols are for them the best. But please, if you make a protocol, forget the word if. Okay? If the patient was 4 hours with the membranes, fluids, you give cefazolin. If the patient is less than 4 hours, don't give. No. Let's put everyone should receive cefazolin. Easier. So no confusion and everyone follows. The worst in medicine is the if. We could understand, they not. So in MSF, you will not see any protocol that says if. That's good. And blood transfusion also is a problem. In a lot of contexts, they don't give blood. For whatsoever belief. They can see that the people dying, they don't give blood. They don't give. In some places also should be avoided because the prevalence of HIV or hepatitis C might be so high that you say, okay, if I'm going to give blood, I might contact this patient. That's why in MSF at least, we have very severe indications for blood transfusion. We don't give to right and the left. We have very, 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 very strong things to give. Because not only because hepatitis C or HIV, because the patient might be in the window time because we test the blood. The problem also is that we only check ABO and ERASH. We don't check all the other antigens. So you can have a patient that receive one blood of one patient, they receive a second package of another donor, and then all this blood in between become completely they are not compatible, so you have the patient dying of anaphylactic shock. So we need to be very careful with that blood. And never forget, even wherever you are, if you receive blood, before giving, again, test it yourself. Because you don't know how it was done. You never know. Sometimes in one project in Burundi, we got that 20% of the bags we were receiving were contaminated. HIV, 20%. So you need to really control. And of course, forget of plasma, of all these fancy things, you know. Factor 12, factor 14, no. We only have fresh blood, in a lot of places we cannot have even a fridge, so we use fresh blood. Saying this, please, 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 do not give yourself your own blood. Yeah? Because if something happens with a patient, they will say that you did something, you know, witchery, because a patient is dying. These people don't understand. Yeah? And also because you're the doctor. And if you get back because you give blood, who is going to take care of the patient? So in MSF we say nobody of the team dealing with the patient gives their own blood. I need to say that I give it twice. Because you are in a situation that you say, oh my God, this patient will die. But officially I need to say no, no and no. When I did it very, okay, we went to the OT, was the expat nurse taking me the blood. Then another came there saying, okay, nobody relied that it was me. And then I came running on also, so they will not say that. But anyway, I don't fall down. But yeah, it's better not. Also, it's because I was in the field, nobody briefed me about this. Yeah, when I was in South Sudan, I was sent by an airplane developing, but now I will not, because there are so many concerns that sometimes, sorry to say, sometimes better is not to operate the patient. It's better that the patient dies in front of their family. And sometimes it's better not to do something that will be worse for the patient. And then I will ask you, I don't know, who can answer this ethical question? You have A positive, for example. No, A negative blood. And this woman has a postpartum hemorrhage. You have a unit. It's with HIV. What do you do? You give it or you don't give it? You say no. Why?
Because it's a fundamental rule in medicine not to do harm.
Not to do harm. But the patient will die.
Not from my intervention.
Yeah. Another? Someone thinks differently? Yes? Someone says yes? Like, you know?
Are you willing to take the risk to give the patient HIV now and to give her life, and then she might give the disease to her husband, her future daughters, or maybe she will not find the medication?
Yeah. Yeah. That's you answered perfect. You read our policy in HIV. So normally we don't give, because it's not because I'm saving the life of the woman now. What you said after was the best answer. What is going to happen afterwards? So she might get birth, she might contaminate her husband. You know, so this comes, you know, it spreads. The only thing sometimes in some projects where you have assured post-exposure prophylaxis, we can do it. Or if you have treatment. But by default, we know, no way. And if the blood has syphilis,
this might be,
yeah, we give it because the patient is going to die. But then ceftriaxone, okay. But I think your answer was very good. Ethics, please, ethics. We should not think only what is going to happen immediately, but in the future, this woman might be a danger to her own community. So I'm ending already, but so I told geographically can be a problem because we need to know the diseases that are there. I remember in my first mission, we don't have almost tuberculosis in my country. So when I see a patient with fever and coughing, the first thing to my mind that comes is pneumonia. Yeah? And I came to Bor. And, oh, the patient is coughing, fever, pneumonia. No, it's malaria. But I don't have malaria. So when you go to, wherever you go, you need to check what are the diseases that are there, because your patient might have not only the surgical disease, but also something that is there. Yeah? Malnutrition, tuberculosis. So you need to understand at least what is. Do you know the rapid tests of malaria? Because you don't have malaria here. Yeah. There are rapid tests. Also, I didn't know that there need to be a line that if it doesn't color, it's negative. I didn't know. I need to learn all in the, you know, running. But you need to know what is going on. But never forget that local staff might know more than you in this kind of diseases. So never say no. We had a case in Sierra Leone where they have Lassa fever. Lassa fever is a hemorrhagic fever that can kill people. Not as Ebola, but that can kill. And it's endemic in Sierra Leone. I think that the local staff in our maternity, they knew. As you see, this patient has. So once there was a discussion between the gynecologist international and the local staff. The local staff saying, this patient might have Lassa fever. She's saying no, because I don't see any signs of Lassa fever. But she is from a country that absolutely there's no Lassa fever. She read the book. And when you read the book, the book is fantastic, but it's not what the experience gives you. So they didn't test the patient. And three people got sick afterwards. And they were thinking, what caused you to check the patient? You know what cost? Is your own satisfaction, your own ego. And unfortunately, doctors were very, our ego is very big. And sometimes our ego can get broken if a nurse tells us something. But this nurse might know much more than you. So please, in this context, hear to everyone. And also, you can get sick of this. Then consent form. Even in this context, we ask people to sign the consent form. You cannot operate someone because you are the humanitarian. No, no, no. They need to know. You need every time where we go, we need to respect the local. We try to respect the local culture and behavior. You know, for me, for example, Afghanistan is very difficult because women, they use this very long, but then here it goes like this. You know, and in OT, every time they are, you know, so it's, but it's very difficult to say them, you put it because the culture is like this. Yeah, and sometimes also relatives live in the hospital. Sometimes your hospital is like a refugee camp because you have all the family living with the family. If it's a woman, she has 5 children, the 5 children are with her because who's going to take care of her? Of the children, not of her, of the children. So remember, you will go. If you go in humanitarian, you might be in short times because it's very harsh, it's very strong the work. So protocols, because after you will come another one, so if you are changing protocols every 5 days, everyone gets completely sick. You need to be able to set it up in circumstance. This is a photo of a cave in Syria, in Jabal Akrat. It's a photo of me, actually. So this was like a cave where they put apples. Yeah. After harvest. So we did a little operating room that was in this tent, but you see the patients on the floor, patients in this mattress without even, so we could find whatever we would find there, but it's very difficult. Living conditions can be a camping, and you need to be prepared. In humanitarian, you need to be prepared physically and mentally, yeah? Fatigue is very, that's why we said for soldiers and it is go only 3 months maximum. I was the only one crazy that was 9 months. I was also younger, much younger than now. I don't think that I could afford 9 months there. And be prepared. These photos are from Kunduz. This was before the bombing, so this is the emergency area, and the fight was in the city already. So we're coming a lot of civilians wounded. So the hospital, 120 beds, they didn't have beds anymore place. So all the staff, not duty, on duty, everyone was working. Patients were on the floor wherever they were working. You can't believe how you can work in these conditions. You need to be very, very strong because also you don't know your family is in danger out the hospital. And then this is after the bombing, when all this area was completely destroyed and the staff that managed to leave, they ran in again, took all the patients they could take, and they began to treat them. This is the place where they did the morning meeting. And they, you see, here they have even covers, so rugs. So how you can, patients with rugs, that's because they have in another place. And I didn't put a photo, an horrible photo, where they wanted to try to do surgery of that emergency doctor that was amputated by a bomb on the kitchen table. because you need to say to the patient, you need to these people, they should have a monument because they save a lot of life after the bombing, even that they were traumatized because they were in the bombing. So I don't know how I should have reacted, but they were magnificent. So the environment can be bleak and harsh. The limits in surgical care are determined by difficulties, by supply, by lack of maintenance. You're in a dangerous area. What is essential must be differentiated from what is nice to have. Yeah? And last but not least, the adverse conditions put the safety of patients and medical personnel at risk. You can get tired, frightened, so your staff might not work correctly because they have the premise back home. In the earthquake of Haiti, we have surgeons that were sleeping, Haitians. And some international shouting, "Why are they sleeping?" I said, look, don't shout to him, because he all day is making guard at his house not to get looted. And in the earthquake, he lost his wife and his two children. And on top of that, now you come to shout to him. You know, because it's very easy when you come to help. But the people that are there, really, they need also help. Yeah? So you need to be prepared for everything. And you should be psychologically adapted. This is a photo of a girl of Kunduz also, during the attack, during the bombing. Yeah? When you see this, you know, babies, it's horrible. Babies. An adult is not so frightened. This girl is alive. It's alive. But when you see this, you don't know even from where to begin. And I don't know if being alive in this condition is good for this girl or not in Afghanistan. Yeah, but we saved a life. We don't come to decide to be God. We saved a life, but we need to be prepared to see all these kind of things. And remain every time capable. This is the kitchen. They are trying to save the life of the doctor. This is Kunduz after the aftermath of that. Yeah, and then all my anesthesiologists in the field will say you thanks for your attention. The good thing in the field is you become very clinical. You will remember your book of medicine, and you will forget your laboratory tests. And it's very nice because you become a very good doctor. Yeah. So okay, things okay. So thanks for attention, and I hope that you didn't get frightened, but it's the truth, what happens in the world. Unfortunately, 90% of the population gets this scare. You are living in a bubble. All the other world lives like this. Yeah. Don't forget that. Thank you.